Hepsine tabii teker teker teşekkür etmek istiyorum. Özellikle katılımlarından dolayı ve bizde paylaşımlarından dolayı. İlk konuşmacımız Profesör Doktor Myers, Güney Afrika Cumhuriyeti'nden bize geldi ve temel sağlık merkezlerinde uyuşturucu kullanımına müdahale edilmesi, fırsatlar ve zorluklar isimli bir konuşma sunacak. Buyurun.
Thank you very much for the invitation to be here. I'm really excited to be in your beautiful country and to share some of our experiences from South Africa in developing and implementing screening and brief interventions in primary healthcare settings. So I don't know how much you know about South Africa. We are the southernmost country on the continent of Africa, and we are doubly challenged by high levels of substance use disorders as well as a generalized HIV epidemic where about 18% of our adult population are infected with HIV. In terms of substance use disorders, about our national figures suggest that 13% of our population, of our adult population, will have a substance use disorder in their lifetime. In some provinces in the country, this is upwards of 20%. And apart from the diagnosable substance use disorders, we have among the highest levels of hazardous and harmful drinking amongst drinkers in the world. And this, this map just reflects the per capita levels of alcohol consumption amongst current drinkers. Despite these wide-ranging problems related to alcohol and other drug use, our substance abuse treatment system is underdeveloped. We only have about 16,000 to 18,000 places available for substance abuse treatment, and we're still struggling to address racial and gender disparities in access to services and a fragmented service that is the legacy of our oppressive apartheid regime that ended in the 90s. Can I go? Okay. All right. I'm sorry about the technical difficulty. I'm going to start again. So I'm going to be talking about our experience from South Africa in terms of delivering screening and brief interventions in primary care. And for those of you who don't know, South Africa is the southernmost country on the continent of Africa. And we have very serious problems with substance use disorders. Our best statistics that we have suggest that up to 13% of our general adult population in their lifetime will experience a substance use disorder, and this increases to more than 20% in some provinces of the country. And we also have a serious problem with hazardous and harmful alcohol use. And the recent evidence suggests that we are have the dubious reputation of being a country with amongst the highest per capita levels of drinking globally, as well as per capita heavy episodic drinking. Despite this, South Africa's substance abuse treatment system is underdeveloped. We have about 16,000 to 18,000 treatment places available annually, And we're still struggling to address historical disparities in terms of access to care that are a legacy of the oppressive apartheid regime. This slide reflects the optimal mix of services for mental health service delivery, but it can also be applied to the optimal mix of services required for substance abuse treatment service delivery or substance abuse interventions. Right at the top of the pyramid, you would have the specialized substance abuse treatment, either in inpatient or hospital-based services, and below that, sort of standalone outpatient and community-based services. We have some of those services available in South Africa, but the lower levels of care, which are really important to halt the progression of substance use from sort of the early problems to more severe substance use disorders, are completely missing in our context. We have a few self-help groups, but we don't have the informal community care and services available in our primary healthcare services. Based on this, and together with support from the Department of Health, we have initiated a couple of pilot projects to implement screening brief interventions and referral to treatment services in various primary healthcare services in the country. So why SPIRT? Well, there's evidence for the effectiveness of screening brief interventions and referral to treatment in terms of halting the progression of substance use from sort of early use, early problematic use to more severe abuse and dependence. There's also evidence that amongst people with more high-risk patterns of substance use, if you intervene with brief interventions, you can build readiness to change and help connect them with substance abuse treatment services. Delivering these services in primary healthcare settings is also very promising because many people wouldn't normally seek out substance abuse treatment, at least in our context, because of the stigma associated with saying, well, I have a substance abuse problem and I need help. But certainly for people with alcohol problems, a lot of them do present in primary healthcare settings for associated health problems. So there might be a window of opportunity to intervene with people who wouldn't ordinarily seek services. And it's particularly important in South Africa's primary healthcare system because we have a very well-developed primary healthcare system that reaches every poorer, lower socioeconomic status community in the country. And these primary healthcare services, however, have been completely overburdened with a quadruple burden of infectious diseases related to HIV and TB. And more recently, we've seen a very big problem of increasing prevalence of non-communicable diseases such as hypertension, as well as mental health problems. And then, at least in some of the provinces, we see a lot of burden related to alcohol-related violence and injuries. So addressing substance use often contributes to the progression and acquisition of these infectious and communicable and non-communicable diseases. And so addressing this might actually have a positive impact and help the healthcare system to respond effectively to these other health problems. The challenge in delivering SPIRT in primary healthcare settings in South Africa, as in many low and middle income countries, is that we have a resource challenge. In some of the high income countries, SPIRT has been delivered using mental health professionals and doctors. But as you can see from the table over here, we have per capita, per 100,000 population in South Africa, we actually have very few mental health professionals and we have very few doctors. Our primary healthcare services are predominantly nurse-delivered services with some supervision from a doctor. So we do have a much better representation of nurses and midwives in our context. And we also have a very large cadre of healthcare workers referred to as community healthcare workers, who are lay people who have been trained and been given a diploma in providing community-based health services. And these were predominantly trained as a first-line response to the HIV epidemic, as well as to provide adherence monitoring for TB control. So the South African government has adopted a task-shifting approach to delivering mental health and substance abuse services in primary care settings. And there's quite a lot of evidence now. There's a recent Cochrane review which supports that task-shifting can be an effective way of expanding access to mental health and substance use services. There are four levels of task shifting, and this is when specialized tasks are shifted from specialty medical staff to non-specialty staff. And the four levels of task shifting include task shifting to doctors in general practice, task shifting to nurses, to community health workers, and to people living with the disorder. The South African government in the primary healthcare system is supporting task shifting to level 2 and level 3 tiers of staff. So I'm going to provide you briefly with three examples of screening and brief intervention and referral programs in primary and healthcare settings that have adopted various degrees of a task shifting approach. The first is the Uister Day Hospital project. This is a primary hospital, healthcare, provides a full range of medical services. And what they were seeing is that they saw a lot of cases of people with mental health problems that were substance use related, yet they had no substance abuse services and nowhere to refer these patients within the catchment area of the hospital. So they developed a vertically integrated substance abuse treatment center, which means it was a completely standalone center that provided services delivered by dedicated personnel. And they developed the substance abuse center to respond to the need for substance abuse services. The process of care was that nurses in the hospital would screen patients coming for a whole range of health problems for substance use. If they detected someone with a substance use problem, they would refer them to an auxiliary social worker at the center who would use the assist to screen for substance use involvement and then provide feedback to the patient based on their score. And then if the person screened positive for moderate or high involvement in substance use, they would receive a brief motivational intervention delivered by a social worker. And for those with high involvement, they would be referred on to specialist substance abuse treatments. Just some key findings on the acceptability, feasibility, and initial outcomes of this intervention from a 3-month evaluation. We found that universal screening did not occur. Over the period of the pilot implementation, only 127 people were screened and referred to the center. And all of these, what nurses did is that they case detected. So if it was clear that they didn't just conduct universal screening, but they really sort of cherry-picked those people that they really suspected had a substance use problem. The positive news is that of these people who were referred to the center they received a brief intervention, we saw positive reductions in all classes of substance use. Alcohol was the predominant substance, but 44% actually had polysubstance use, with cannabis and methamphetamine being the primary illicit drugs of use. 68% of the patients who received this intervention were also referred to treatment because they had high levels of substance use involvement. However, we saw a very low level of uptake of referrals, less than half. And of those people who did take up their referral, most of them were not satisfied with the level of care they received in specialty care. So there really is a lot of improvement that needs to happen in terms of the referral to treatment aspect of the SPIRT paradigm. I now want to move on, and I know I'm going through this very fast, to what I think is a very exciting initiative to introduce substance use services into emergency departments. In all of our primary healthcare clinics, we have a 24-hour emergency department, so where people can present at any time of the day with illness or injury, and they're triaged according to the severity of illness. And if it is not a life-threatening situation, then they are provided with medical care on free medical care on site. These emergency departments are unbelievably busy over weekends and around paydays, and this is largely due to alcohol-related violence and alcohol-related injuries. So with this burden on the services that, and people not being able to cope with their workload, the Department of Health really identified the need to intervene and help reduce the burden through addressing alcohol use in particular. So they introduced a vertically integrated services delivered by community healthcare workers. So community healthcare workers conducted universal screening of patients presenting in selected emergency departments for alcohol and other drug use using the ASSIST. And patients were offered, if they screened positive, were offered a brief intervention, and we actually randomized people to one of three interventions. So the title of this project is Project STRIVE, which stands for Substance Use and Trauma Intervention. And this slide just shows the process of care in which we randomized people into either a psychoeducation control group where they received an information brochure only, or they received one session of motivational interviewing, which was linked to the ASSIST-led intervention, or they received five sessions of a blended motivational interviewing and problem-solving therapy intervention. And the paper in the symposium booklet will outline this intervention in more detail. Once they had received the intervention, had high levels of substance use involvement, they were also referred on to care. Our community health care workers in the initial implementation period managed to screen more than 2,700 people, of which about 19% were eligible to participate in the study. So there was a significant need for this intervention. Our interventions and the idea of a brief intervention actually had quite a lot of high acceptability for patients. 74% were actually willing to receive an intervention and to discuss their substance use, which I think is quite remarkable in an emergency department. But the providers did give feedback about some challenges in terms of universal screening, particularly approaching very intoxicated or very injured patients to ask about their substance use. In terms of the feasibility of a five-session intervention, we did find in qualitative interviews post this implementation period that participants really would have preferred 3 to 4 sessions rather than 5 sessions, just because of the logistics in terms of returning for further appointments. Although some people did say they actually would have liked more sessions. But 58% completed all 5 sessions. So we found that after session 4, there was a drop off in terms of attendance. In terms of acceptability of a community healthcare worker-delivered intervention, the providers really liked this. They said that in a busy emergency room department, they really needed dedicated staff. We couldn't designate or ask the nurses delivering the emergency services to also screen for substance use and conduct an intervention in that setting. They were already overburdened. In terms of outcomes, we found significant reductions in substance use across all three intervention groups. And very interestingly, whether a person received an information brochure or a one-session motivational intervention, there was actually no significant difference in terms of the outcomes. So both the people in the information arm of the study and in the motivational interviewing, one-session motivational interviewing arm of the study improved equally. However, we did find that people who were randomized to our motivational interviewing and problem-solving intervention group did significantly better in terms of reducing their substance use outcomes and actually improving their, reducing their the number of depressive symptoms than people in either the motivational interviewing or the information control group. So this really suggests that the longer intervention that includes building skills to address problem solving and coping is more effective than a very brief intervention. We also have conducted a preliminary cost-effective analysis which found that the blended motivational interviewing problem-solving therapy intervention was more cost-effective to deliver than either the motivational interviewing or information control group. The final project that I want to talk about briefly is an antenatal support project. In South Africa, we have midwife obstetric-run units that deliver antenatal care in all our primary health care clinics. These are completely midwife-run, and pregnant women in poor communities will present for all of the antenatal care at these clinics, and they will even, if they have an uncomplicated pregnancy, they will even deliver their babies in these settings. And many of the poorer communities in the province where I live, the Western Cape, there are very high levels of fetal alcohol spectrum disorders and alcohol use and tobacco use amongst pregnant women, and as well as very high levels of pre- and postnatal depression. So this intervention was conceived as a way of helping women cope with the psychosocial stresses that they experience during pregnancy and also to reduce the risks of substance use both for mother and infants. This intervention was piloted at one very busy maternal obstetric unit. On an average month, this unit sees about 650 first appointments for antenatal care. There are about 2,200 follow-ups and about 300 deliveries that occur at this midwife-run facility. So the APSUP project is a horizontally integrated screening and brief intervention and referral to treatment program, which is completely nurse and community healthcare worker delivered. And it's delivered by staff who are already working in this facility. So the process of care is that on intake at the person's first appointment, there's a history-taking nurse that will screen the pregnant woman for depression. If she screens positive for depression, she's referred on to specialist services. After the woman's history is taken, she's referred to, which is standard practice in South Africa, HIV testing and counseling for initiation of prevention of mother-to-child transmission of HIV if she's positive. And what was this HIV counselor is a community health worker who's specially trained in HIV counseling. And she was trained also to provide screening for alcohol, tobacco, and other drug use. And if the woman screened positive, to deliver a brief intervention known as the 5 A's, which has shown efficacy in other settings for tobacco use, but we adapted it to also address alcohol and illicit drug use. And she, as part of this 5 A's, women are given self-help materials also to help support changes in alcohol, tobacco, and other drug use. And then they receive their usual care, and if they were high-risk users, they were supposed to be referred to treatment, to specialist treatments. In terms of feasibility and acceptability of the intervention, we found that although many women over the 6 months of the pilot phase of the evaluation period received care at this facility, actually only 43% were screened. So universal screening did not happen. We also found significantly lower rates of substance use disclosure than expected for this population. Epidemiological surveys suggest that at least a third of women will be using alcohol or other drugs during pregnancy. We found that only 2% disclosed. The tobacco was slightly lower as well. We, and in this setting, we expect at least 45% of women to smoke tobacco during pregnancy. Women's preliminary responses to the intervention, we found that participants were able to reduce their tobacco use after receiving the intervention, but we found no response for women who disclosed alcohol and other drug use. But we also think this might be because of the power, because there are actually very few women completed the intervention who were using alcohol and other substances. And there was no referral to care for women who were using other substances. In terms of the healthcare workers' perceptions of barriers, remember this was a horizontally integrated service, so healthcare workers were expected to provide this intervention service on top of their other duties. And they all said that they thought this was a wonderful program and they wanted it to be continue to be implemented, but they mentioned that they were already overloaded and couldn't always screen and deliver the services. Some of the healthcare workers were unclear about their roles and thought that they hadn't been properly consulted, and they were concerned that women didn't disclose their alcohol, tobacco, and other drug use to them. And they also mentioned a lack of referral pathways, that in this community there was nowhere to send women if they actually did disclose alcohol or other drug use in terms of specialist treatment. So we've learned, we've had some challenges and we've learned some lessons in terms of implementing screening and brief interventions in primary care. We found promising outcomes, but our follow-up period has been very short. So we recognize that we need to have more studies which look at the duration of effects and also cost effectiveness in order for us to sell this to the Department of Health. We have also, in all of our studies and in similar experiences with delivery of brief mental health interventions, we've noted that universal screening doesn't occur. And we're now trying to think of a creative strategy for ensuring that screening does occur. And what we've come up with is an incremental approach to screening for substance use disorders, in which we try and identify patients who are not responding to their healthcare advice or not adhering to their medication regimes, and screening those high-risk patients for substance use disorders. And our plan is, if we can get it working with the high-risk patients, we'll expand screening slowly over time to include the whole cohort of patients seeking care in primary healthcare settings. We also have some unanswered questions about how best to integrate SPIRT into primary healthcare services, whether we should adopt a vertically integrated approach where there are dedicated staff who are solely responsible for delivering substance use services, and for this route we would have to go the community healthcare worker route, or whether we would be just as effective in terms of delivering a horizontally integrated staff service using staff who are currently employed. There are obviously resource implications for this, and we are poised to conduct a study which actually compares the effectiveness and the cost effectiveness of a vertically integrated versus a horizontally integrated approach to implementing SPIRT in primary healthcare services in South Africa. The other major challenge is the feasibility of referral to treatment for people who screen positive for high-risk substance use and who need more than a brief intervention to change their substance use involvement. We found the major lesson that we've learned is that we can't assume that patients, if we give them a referral, that they will be they will end up taking that referral or getting additional care. So we've identified the need to strengthen the linkages between primary care and specialist treatment services. And we've also identified decided that we are, instead of just providing a one or two session brief intervention in primary care, we'll make it slightly longer so that patients receive a little more of an intensive brief intervention, because ethically we can't just send them away without anything. So I've spoken a little bit about our future plans. And all that is left is to acknowledge our various sources of funding, and in particular, the leadership and insight of the Western Cape Department of Health, who've really been driving the delivery of screening and brief interventions in primary care for substance use disorders. Thank you.
Profesör Mayıs'a teşekkür ediyoruz. Bir zaman problemimiz olacak. O yüzden soruları en sonunda alalım istiyoruz. Şimdi İngiltere'den bir konuşmacımız var. Mr. Brown bize gençlere yönelik erken müdahale ve tedavi konusunda bilgiler aktaracak. Buyurun.
Hello. Thank you very much for inviting me to come and talk to you today about issues of brief interventions and early intervention and treatment for young people in my case, hopefully my presentation, there we go. So I'm the director of policy for Drug Scope, which is, this isn't working, oh there we go. Drug Scope, which is the national membership organisation for the drug and alcohol sector in the UK. We represent about 400 organisations and individuals who are interested in treatment, prevention, and academic research in the area of addictions. Where am I going? Yeah, I thought I'd start with some context. So, in the UK, prevalence of drug misuse is falling amongst adults and young people, but it's still high by international comparisons. The immediate costs associated with substance misuse by young people in the UK is estimated to be about £100 million a year. The cost of individual problem drug use over the course of a lifetime has been estimated to be in between 820,000 and £859,000, depending on whether it's a man or a woman. The women's costs are higher because of childcare costs. Interventions to stop young people before the age of 21 going on to have a substance misuse problem are estimated to save most of those costs. So £736,000 would be saved if we could prevent young people going on to having problematic drug misuse. There's a bit of a delay here. Okay, so early treatment for young people under 18 has a benefit to cost ratio in the UK of between £4.5 and £8.5 for every pound that's invested. That compares with adult treatment cost ratios of between £2.50 for every pound that's invested in adult treatment. So earlier treatment has better cost outcomes, it appears. And it's also worth noting that in the UK, one in seven deaths of people in their 20s and 30s is related to substance misuse, and in particular to illegal drug use. So skipping through this quite quickly, there's about 1.5 million people last year who took illegal drugs before the age of 25. And as you can see, and as you perhaps might expect, that's slightly larger in the age group of 16 to 24 than it is in the younger age group. But by the age of 15, about 1 in 5 young people say that they took an illegal drug in the UK. I think I heard Bronwyn say that there were about 20,000 treatment places in the whole of South Africa. Well, we have about that many people under the age of 18 in treatment in the UK. As you can see, slightly falling over recent years. And interestingly, for me at least, There's been a divergence between the two main problem substances that young people turn up in treatment, a fall off in the number of people who are coming because of their alcohol misuse, and an increase, slight increase in the numbers who are coming because of cannabis misuse. And that's runs slightly contrary to the general prevalence data, where cannabis use amongst young people has been steadily falling and has been a big contributor to the falls in drug use that you saw earlier in my presentation. Young people come to treatment services, to the specialist services, through a variety of routes, but most importantly they are referred through our criminal justice system, through the youth justice system, which is the bar on the left there, and then in the middle, the other bigger bar, is through education services. Otherwise, there are about 10% who self-refer or are referred by families and friends. Similarly for health services and social care, and through substance misuse services themselves. We have guidance from our National Institute for Care and for Health and Care Excellence, which is based on a reading of the evidence base as it stands at the moment. And they suggest to local areas what they should be doing, which includes developing a local strategy, using the tools that they have around them, the screening tools and other tools, to identify and assess the levels of risks in their community, working with parents and carers and other organizations involved with children and young people to provide support, and referring them on to specialist services. The use of motivational interviews with those who are misusing substances, and offering group behavioral therapy to children who are persistently aggressive or disruptive and as therefore perhaps at high risk of substance misuse. And then offering family-based programs and structured support for children who are 11 to 16 who are disadvantaged and deemed at high risk of substance misuse. I'm going to talk a little bit about brief interventions and a project that I ran when I was working for a charity called Mentor. But before doing so, I think it's worth pointing out some of the limitations of, in terms of the evidence base for brief interventions. There are three Cochrane reviews here. One of a school-based intervention which suggests it's a promising approach, particularly for cannabis, but it's too early to say. There haven't been enough studies done for the reviewers to say this is a, you know, the way forward. Secondly, a review of motivational interviewing for prevention of alcohol misuse amongst young adults, which found that it had little effect and no substantive or meaningful benefits from it. And then the third one, which suggested that long-term behavior changes and the evidence for that are weak, and that other active treatments, treatment as usual, and being assessed and receiving feedback can be as effective as motivational interviewing. So the really big, quite big limitations about what we know about the effect of motivational interviewing and other brief interventions. Nevertheless, it looks to us as if it might be a promising way forward, partly because of its acceptability to the population and to deliverers as well. And so that's what I'm going to hopefully talk about. So I'm talking about a project I ran, which is called Street Talk, which was a project to train youth workers to deliver brief interventions to vulnerable young people. It was a short conversation in a youth work setting, either in a club or on the street, with young people who we had screened using the CRAFT screening tool. So a very brief screening tool to suggest what level of risk they might be running, and then to explore that further as part of a brief intervention. One of the innovations we used in doing this was to put the screening tool onto a mobile phone and onto tablets, which meant that they were very attractive to young people. They came and they gave us the information that we asked of them, and they didn't feel as if they were having to fill out pieces of paper, which is very boring, It gave us the ability to follow them up. We asked them to give us their mobile phone numbers as their individual signifiers, which allowed it to be anonymous and allowed us to text them and know that they were part of our study. We had security around the data. It wasn't shared with anybody else. And we had real-time information that we could use to understand what was going on in terms of the numbers of interventions that were taking place. So we knew which youth workers were doing the interventions, and we could track back how effective they might have been as well. So quickly, as you can see, mostly they were under 18. There was a fairly good split between boys and girls. You can see that most young people were taking either low risk or no risk. That's the two on the left-hand side. And then about 40% were taking medium to severe risks in their substance misuse, as assessed through the screening tools that we used. So 807 people out of the 2,000 we screened were eligible for an intervention. The disclosure of substance misuse, well, as you can see, many young people disclosed that they'd used alcohol, but the way that they used it was important to our decision about whether they entered the intervention group. And about half of them said that they had used cannabis, and a smaller group had said that they used other drugs as well. And about 35% of people said that they had polydrug use, so they were using two or more substances at the same time. The point of this slide is just to show that those people who are in the intervention group, the ones in the pink, they were all more likely to take part in antisocial behavior and crime than their peer group who didn't get the intervention. So we're pretty sure that we were focused on the right group of people. These were people who were already engaging in low levels of antisocial behavior and some cases in quite important criminal activities such as selling drugs. The sorts of behaviors that young people disclosed to us in terms of their risks were getting into trouble, their families and friends saying that they were concerned about them already. About 43% said that that was the case. Just over 60% saying that they either used to forget or had forgotten and blacked out as a result of their drug use. We weren't quite sure about what their answers meant on that. Using when they were alone, so almost half of people said that. Lots saying that they used them to relax, which is perhaps not surprising. And almost 60% said that they had been in a car where somebody else had been intoxicated. Quickly, the results in terms of the most basic level of the results told us that the young people felt more confident about going to find somewhere to get support should they need it. And they also said that they felt better at being able, more informed about being able to take choices in their own lives about substance misuse as a result of the intervention. You can see across this that what we found was that the intention to use more safely in the future, that they would prefer to be safer in the future, that significant others would, in their lives, their families and friends, would want them to take better choices, and that their confidence about being able to go on and do so, it's almost 70% across all of those said that that would be their preferred outcome as a result of this intervention. We know that the intention to change often isn't translated into actual change, but it's a good, I think, starting point for showing the kind of the positivity of such an approach with this sort of age group and people taking these sorts of risks. So the key findings from the project were that we thought that youth workers, the people that we trained, had the skills to be able to provide an early intervention with young people, and they also had the right mindset to do it. They wanted to work positively with young people. They wanted to engage with them in their own learning and in their own health behaviours. And we also found that a large majority of the young people who took part had a positive desire to deal with the risks that they were running and had a better understanding of how to do it. We found that these services need not be delivered by specialist services, that youth workers and universal settings were a good place to find young people and to deliver the interventions, and that we think that they are there was a good fit between youth workers and the sorts of methodologies that we were trying. And then finally, that the smartphones and tablets and the web surveys were very effective at engaging young people. We have very little attrition as a result of this. We found people gave us the information and then came back and did a substantially longer survey a little while later to tell us about their other behaviours. So to conclude, so working with young people in treatment is not only about problem and on drug use, but about multiple needs. Young people who are misusing substances often have other things going on in their lives. Their family relationships may not be good. Their mental health may be breaking down. Their relationship with their other institutions like schools may be very fragile. And so treating all of those things at the same time is a really important part of young people's work. We think that not all interventions need to be delivered by specialist services. There are other people out there, school teachers we heard a lot about in the session before this, youth workers in our case, primary care providers also, people who work in sexual health settings. These are all good people to deliver interventions around substance misuse. A lot of the work done by specialist drug and alcohol services is not really treatment as you would imagine it in terms of adult treatment. It's a lot of it is psychosocial and about helping young people to come to terms with growing up and helping them to understand the level of risk that they may be running. We think that polysubstance use creates a new challenge for services. The idea that just young people just use one drug at a time isn't the case anymore, and there are increasing number of young people we find who are using quite a wide range of substances, and that makes it very complicated as to both the outcomes for them and the sorts of services that need to be on offer. We don't think that it's right to trust to judge young people services by the same indicators that you might use for adult treatment. And that we think the key challenges are between the gaps between young people services and adult services. You know, a lot of people who go on to develop those serious drug and alcohol problems, the ones that cost us so much money, start in their teenage years and finding a way to make sure that when the problems that they might be experiencing at the age of 18 are taken as seriously by adult services as by young people services. It is a really important part of thinking through these challenges. We think that young people are often involved in supply. When we talk to young people, what they tell us is they get their drugs from each other, not from drug dealers. Obviously, somebody does, but there's a lot of social supply, and those young people need to be to have interventions that are specifically tailored towards them. And that we need to make sure that there are environmental prevention techniques as well as the individual techniques. So invest in your community and social regeneration as well as one-to-one support. And that's me done. Thank you very much.
Evet, teşekkür ediyoruz Mr. Brown'a. Şimdi hemen vakit kaybetmeden Gültekin hocamızı davet ediyorum. Madde kullanımı ve bağımlılıklarında bireyselleştirilmiş müdahaleyi anlatacak bize bugün.
Evet. Öncelikle hepinize merhaba diyorum. Benden önceki konuşmacılara çok teşekkür ediyorum. Çünkü aslında benim konuşmam onların üstüne gelmesi çok iyi oldu. Kendileri çok güzel bir şekilde tüm konulardan söz etmiş oldular. Ben birazcık daha konumu halk sağlığı sempozyumu olduğuna göre bu sempozyum biraz daha o temel üstüne oturtarak yapmaya çalışacağım. Ama tabii ki genel hedefim erken ve kısa müdahaleler üstünden söz etmek. Bu 2013'te yapılan bir derlemeden aldığım bir çalışma. Burada kısa müdahalelerin aslında ne kadar etkin olduğunu görüyoruz. Ama burada benim asıl vurgulamak istediğim, alt tarafa baktığınızda özellikle kısa müdahalelere aile katılıyorsa, ailenin etkinliğinde tedavinin başarısını ve süregen olmasını sağlayan bir faktör olarak görüyoruz. Yani tek başına evet kısa müdahaleler etkin yöntemler. Fakat aile işin içine girdiğinde müdahalenin kalitesi ve sürekliliği çok daha artıyor. O yüzden tek başına kısa müdahaleyi almak ve onun yanında aile müdahalelerini eklemenin önemini tabii gösteriyor. Ama kısa müdahale daha çok nerede etkin sorusu çıkıyor. Aslında her yerde uygulanabilir kısa müdahale. Bağımlılığın her aşamasında kullanılabilecek bir yöntem. Fakat özellikle biliyoruz ki çeşitli yönleri deniyorum ama bir de böyle deneyeyim bakalım. Hah, geldi. Özellikle riskli kullanıcılarda çok daha etkin olduğunu görüyoruz. Çok daha başarı şansının yüksek olduğunu, tedavide başarıyı daha iyi sağladığını biliyoruz. Kötüye konumlarda başarı gene iyi durumda. Fakat başarı oranı biraz daha düşüyor. Tekrar maddeye dönme kişilerin kullanma oranı biraz daha artıyor. Eğer söz konusu bağımlılıksa, evet bağımlılığın bazı alanlarında gene kısa müdahale etkili olabiliyor. Ama biliyoruz ki bağımlılıkta kısa müdahalenin etkinliği diğer iki hedef gruba göre oldukça düşüyor. İşte bu noktada kısa müdahalenin nerede ve ne zaman kullanacağımız sorusu çok önem kazanıyor. Eğer bağımlılıkta artıyor, başarısızsa o zaman bizim bağımlılık şiddetini iyi ölçmemiz gerekiyor. İşte bu noktada bağımlılık şiddeti nedir karşımıza çıkıyor. Şimdi normalde DSM kategorilerinde bildiğimiz şey şu, tanı kriterleri arttıkça, tanı kriterlerinin sayısı arttıkça bağımlılık şiddetini arttığını farz ediyoruz. Ama gerçek öyle mi? Yani bir kişide bağımlılık kriterlerinin 7'si ya da yeni DSM-5'e göre 10'u birden varsa bağımlılık şiddeti daha mı yüksek oluyor? Bütün kriterlerin var olduğunu düşünün ama hepsi çok hafif düzeyde var ama yaşama etkisi çok fazla. Kişinin kullandığı maddenin yaşama etkisi çok fazla veya çok az madde kullanıyor ama az maddeyle çok büyük sorun yaşıyor. Şimdi bunların hepsini bir sepete koyduğumuzda bağımlılık şiddetinin tek başına tanı kriterlerinin sayısıyla ölçemeyeceğimiz ortaya çıkıyor. Bu çalışma İstanbul Amatem'de yaptığımız bir çalışmadan bir veri. Hem bu çalışmada hem de Bafiso çalışmasında birlikte olduğumuz arkadaşım Cüneyt Evren de salonda, belki onda katkıları olabilir. Burada şunu görüyoruz. Bu İstanbul Amatem grubu, tabii şuradan pek gösteremiyoruz. Baktığımızda bir grup, bağımlıların bir grubu tanı kriterlerinde daha çok olanlar var. Bir grubunda madde isteği daha fazla olanlar var. Bir grup ise daha çok motivasyonla ilgili problem olanlar var. Bir grup ve ilk grup aslında faktörde daha çok yaşama olan etkisini görüyoruz. Aslında bu bize şunu gösteriyor. Bağımlılığın şiddeti farklı bağımlılık boyutlarından etkilenen bir durum. Yani bazısında tanı kriterleri sayısı çok olabilir ama bazısında ise yaşama etkisi çok fazla olabilir. Veya bazısında ise yaşama etkisi azdır, bağımlılık tanı kriter sayısı azdır ama şiddetli madde isteği vardır. Şimdi bu tabii bize pratikte neyi sorgulamamız gerektiriyor? O zaman bizim aslında her grup için ayrı bir yaklaşım sergilememiz gerekiyor. Yaşama sorununla yaşama etkisi bağımlılığı çok fazla olan gruplarda farklı bir yöntem uygulamamız lazım. Şiddetli madde isteği olan gruplarda farklı yöntemler uygulamamız lazım. Burada seçeceğimiz müdahalenin kısa veya uzun olması veya burada seçeceğimiz müdahalenin ne uzunlukta yani sıklıkta yapacağımızda yine bir soru işareti oluyor tabii. Bugün aynı çalışmanın devamı. Burada madde kullanım özellikleriyle tanı kriterleri, yaşam üstüne etki ve şiddet isteğin korelasyonlarını görüyorsunuz. Gördüğünüz gibi hiçbir tanesinde %100 yok. Hepsi hatta baktığınızda 73 civarındalar. Yani 80'i bile geçmiyor. Yani demek ki doğrudan bağlantı değiller. Benim tanı kriterleri sayısını çok fazla dolduruyorum ben, olabilirim. Ama benim bu yaşamıma çok etkisi olacağı anlamına gelmiyor. Veya benim yaşamımın etkisi çok fazlaysa benim çok şiddetli madde isteğim olacağı anlamına da gelmiyor. Hepsini bizim ayrı değerlendirip hepsine ayrı bir müdahale yöntemi oluşturabilmemizin önemini vurgulayan bir aslında bulgu olarak değerlendirebiliriz. Erken müdahale tabii burada kısa müdahalenin en etkili olduğu yer ne dedik? Erken müdahale ve yapılan çalışmalarda da aslında bunun önemini çok bize iyi gösteren çalışmalar var. Şunu çok iyi kullanamıyorum. O yüzden örneğin 18 yaşında alkol problemi olan gençlerde 25 yaşında 13 tane olumsuz sonucun hepsinin birlikte gözlendiği görülmüş. Yani aslında 18 yaşındayken kişi problemi sadece alkol problem düzenindeyken 25 yaşındayken artık birçok olumsuz sonucu beraberinde getirmiş. Tabii bu bize çok böyle yavaş geliyor. Ben basıyorum arkadan iki dakika sonra algılıyor ve hızlı gitti bu sefer de. Bize şunu gösteren bir durum. O zaman bizim ergenlikten yetişkinliğe geçtiği dönemde kişiye bir müdahale uygulamamız gerekiyor. Ama ergenlik döneminde kimi alacağız biz? Bağımlıyı mı alacağız? Yoksa birkaç kez madde kullanmış kişiyi mi alacağız? Ve yetişkinlik dönemine geçmeden aslında biz şurada müdahale yaparsak bunun etkinliği çok daha fazla olacaktır. En azından yetişkinlikte bağımlılığın geçmesini önlemiş olacağız. Bir başka çalışma, bu çok güzel yeni bir çalışma, 2014 daha yeni yayınlandı. İlk içkisini 14 yaşında içen gençler bir grubu 15 yaşında ilk sarhoşluğunu yaşıyor. Bir diğer grup ise ilk içkisini 14 yaşında içen ama 18 yaşında ilk sarhoşluğunu yaşayan bir grup var. İkisi arasında bir fark var. Sorunlu alkol kullanımı birinci grupta daha fazla. Yani ilk içki içmemle ilk sarhoşluk dönemim arasındaki sürenin kısalması sorunlu alkol kullanımını artıran bir faktör. Şimdi burada tabii bize önemli yine burada gelen verini. Demek ki burada ilk içkiyle ilk sarhoşluk arasında bir müdahale yapmamız gerekiyor bizim. Eğer o dönemde yakalarsak bu çocuğun daha sonra sorunlu alkol kullanımı haline gelmesinde ya da bağımlılık haline gelmesinde engelleme şansımız olacak. Aslında ilk içkiyi önlememiz için gereken şey ne? Birincil önleme. Ama diğerleri için yapacağımız şey ne? İkincil önleme. Aslında ülkemizdeki en eksik olan taraflardan bir tanesi bu. Bize bağımlılık tedavi kurumları var. Doğru da yanlış önleme çalışmalarımız var. Ama hayatında 3 kere sentetik kanabinoid kullanmış bir genç düşünün. Ne oldu? Amatem'e geldi. Amatem'de kapıda 40 tane eroin bağımlısı bekliyor. Hepsi yoksunluk belirtileri altında. Çok doğal olarak doktor arkadaşımız orada o kadar zaman ayıramayacak o kişiye. Peki nereye gidecek o çocuk? Hadi koçum sen bırak dediniz. Bırakmayacak tabii ki. Arkasından bağımlı olarak tekrar bize geri dönecek. İşte bu noktada mesela kısa müdahalelerin çok daha etkin olduğunu görebiliyoruz. O nedenle de Türkiye için en önemli faktörden bir tanesinin ben ikincil önleme olduğunu, ikincil önlemenin de gerçek anlamda aslında bir tedavi olduğunu düşünüyorum. Aslında bağımlılık bir sonuç, bir sarmalın getirdiği bir sonuç ve bir kısır döngünün yarattığı aslında bir sonuç. Birçok sorun var. Az evvel Sayın Brown bizlere gösterdi. Eşlik eden birçok riskli davranışlar var ve bunlar sonuçta bir bağımlılığa yol açıyor. Ben aslında buraya gelmeyecektim. Neyse. İşte bizim o sorun döneminde müdahale edebildiğimiz zaman zaten bağımlılığın gelişimini önleyebiliriz. İşte bu da tamamen ikinci önlemedir. Bu cezaevi popülasyonundan bir veri, Türkiye'deki cezaevi popülasyonu ilişkili. Dikkat ediyorsanız cezaevi popülasyonunda alkol madde kullananlarda depresyon, anksiyete, intihar, öfke, dürtüsellik hepsi çok daha yüksek. Bu bize şunu gösteriyor. Demek ki çok fazla eşlik eden başka problemler var. Şimdi biz farz edelim sadece bağımlılığı ele aldık bu gruplarda. Nereye kadar gidebileceğiz? Dürtüsellik devam ediyor, dikkat eksik hiperaktivite devam ediyor, depresyon devam ediyor, anksiyete devam ediyorsa çok doğal olarak kişi tekrar madde kullanımına geri dönecektir. İşte bu noktada sorunu tek bir parça olarak ele almak yerine bir bütün olarak ele almak. Belki de kısa müdahaleleri hepsi için ayrıca uygulamak. Gene sunumlarda vardı, depresyon için de kısa müdahaleler söz konusu. Bu nedenle hepsini bir bütün içinde değerlendirip ona göre değerlendirmek, ona göre bir müdahalede bulunmak çok daha iyi sonuçlar verecektir. Ki buradaki tüm veriler hepsi çok da iyi derecede anlamlı gözüküyor farklar arasındaki. Alkol madde kullanan ve kullanmayan cezaevi popülasyon arasındaki farklar. Peki sizce soldaki yüz mü yoksa sağdaki yüz mü öfkeli? Sağdaki yüz diyenler el kaldırsın. Soldakiler diyenler el kaldırsın. Vallahi bilemedim diyenler el kaldırsın. Çok acıktım, el kaldıracak halim yok diyenler. Onlar baş sağlasınlar. Zaten el kaldıracak halleri yoksa. Çok teşekkür ederim. Şimdi bu da çok yeni bir çalışma. Gene 2014, geçen ay yayınlanmış bir çalışma. Dikkat eksikliği hiperaktivitesi olanlar öfkeli yüzü öyle demiyorlar. Aranızda var mıydı bilmiyorum ama tabii gerçekten dikkat eksikliği hiperaktivite bozukluğu olanlar. Şimdi bir bağımlı düşünün. Ne dedik? Dikkat eksikliği hiperaktivite de çok eşlik ediyor. Hatta yine son çalışma şunu gösteriyor. Beyinde aynı merkezden temel alıyor dikkat eksikliği hiperaktivite ve bağımlılık. Bu ayrım yapamayacaklar. Fakat dikkat eksikliği hiperaktivite olmayan bağımlılar var. Onlar bu ayrımı yapıyorlar. Yani bir anlamda şu aslında bir ceza değil mi? Soldaki cezadan anlamamalarını da çok iyi anlıyoruz dikkat eksikliği hiperaktivitleri. Niye cezadan anlamadıkları burada çok net ortaya çıkıyor. Aynı şekilde bunu bir madde kullanan kişi olduğunu düşünün. Şimdi biz bu ayrımı yapmazsak buradaki bağımlıya nasıl müdahale edeceğiz? Ya da burada madde kullanan bir gence nasıl müdahale edeceğiz? Bizim o yüzden muhakkak dikkat eksikliği hiperaktiviteyi de ayırt edebilmemiz gerekiyor. Ve burada biz herhangi bir kısa müdahale ya da herhangi bir başka bir bağımlılığa yönelik müdahale uyguladığımızda acaba gerçekten istediğimiz sonucu alabilecek miyiz? Bu galiba alette sorun değil, bende sorun var. O yüzden bağımlılıkta temel olarak şunu görmemiz gerekiyor. Her bir sorun diğerini tetikliyor. Evet, bu aynı zamanda belki yaygınlığı da bize anlatan bir... Yok, bu kesinlikle benimle ilgili bir soru. O nedenle bazen şu vardı ya, bağımlılar düzelmez ya. Bağımlılıkta ne yaptığınızı soracağız ve ona göre... Kabart ben değil mi? Yok, ben de değilmiş bak. Tamam neyse. İdare ediyoruz artık. Biz onunla alıştık. O yüzden bağımlılıkta etkili değil derken tedavi gerçekten ne yaptığınıza sormak gerekiyor. Sadece bağımlılıkla mı uğraştın? Yoksa tüm alanlara yönelik bir program uyguladın mı? Bir tedavi programı uyguladınız mı? Bunları takip ettiniz ve bunların üstünde bir çalışma yaptınız mı? Bunu bakmamız gerekiyor. Bu bizim gene Cüneyt'le birlikte geliştirdiğimiz bir BopiSoft diye TÜBİTAK desteğiyle geliştirdiğimiz bir program. Bu BopiSoft programında veri girişini direkt madde kullanıcıları kendileri yapıyorlar ve ondan sonra elde ettiğimiz veriyle karşımıza şöyle bir tablo çıkarıyoruz. Hangi ruhsal durumlar var, hangi kişisel özelliklere sahip, madde kullanım isteği, motivasyonu, tanı kriterleri ne durumda? Bu tabloyu görebiliyoruz ve bu bize aslında müdahalede kolaylık sağlıyor. Aynı şekilde programda giriş yaptıktan sonra kişiler Böyle bir rapor ekranı var. Bu rapor ekranında da aslında bizim nereye yöneleceğimizi görüyoruz. Dolayısıyla her madde kullanıcıyı aynı programı uygulamaktansa aslında bize ya bu kişi de buraya dikkat et, bu kişi de şuraya dikkat et bize ortaya çıkaran bir çalışma. Ve bu TÜBİTAK çalışmasında da bunun etkili olabildiğini gördük. Ama tedavinin etkinliğini henüz yapabildiğimiz bir çalışma değil. Denemek isterseniz buradan girebilirsiniz. Microsoft kullanıcı adı deneme diye de şifresiyle girip bakabilirsiniz. Şimdi bu noktada sorun şu. Biz bağımlılıkta tüm tedaviler, tek bir tedavi daha doğrusu bütün sorunları çözebilir mi? Birçoğunuz buraya gelenlerin biliyorlar, Samba diye geçtiğimiz bir program var. Tabii yabancılar için açıklamak lazım, Samba bir dans programı değil, sigara alkol madde bağımlılığının kısaltılmışı oluyor. İlk cezaevinde geliştirdik. Sonra baktık ama olmayacak, çalışmıyor. O yüzden ergenler için Samba CR çıktı. Yani genç Samba programı çıktı. Tek başına aileyi almadan tedavi yaptığınızda bunun etkili olmayacağını gördük. O yüzden şimdi Samba aileyi çıkardık. Onun çalışmaları devam ediyor. Ama bazı kişiler gruba giremiyorlar. Gruptan faydalanmıyorlar. O zaman onlara bireysel bir şey uygulamak lazım. Onun için de şimdi Samba Soft'u geçiyoruz. 6 ay kadar sonra Samba Soft muhtemelen hazır hale gelecek. Ama bir taraftan da bugünün konusu olan erken ve kısa müdahaleler yapmak için gerek üniversitede gerek sağlık kurumlarında uygulayabileceğimiz de bir program olarak da Sambart diye bir program geliştirmeye çalışıyoruz. O da muhtemelen Ocak ayı gibi, Ocak Şubat gibi herhalde hazır olacak. Aslında tek yola çıktığımda ben bir Samba olsun yeter diyordum ama gördüğünüz gibi bitmiyor. Muhakkak her kesime ve her duruma uygun bir program geliştirmek gerekiyor. O yüzden erken ve kısa müdahaleye evet diyoruz. Ama özellikle ikinci dönemde çok önem vermemiz gerektiğini ve özellikle Türkiye için ikinci dönemin çok önemli olduğunu vurgulamak istiyorum. Ve tabii tüm bunları yaparken de muhakkak kişiye özgü programların seçilmesinin gerekli olduğunu düşünüyorum. Teşekkürler.
Konuşmacımız Doktor Möller, adli yargı sisteminde tedaviyi anlatacak. Buyurun.
I'm sorry we are so late before lunch, so but I will be very brief in this presentation. I just need it on the screen so we can start. Thank you. Do I need that one or this one? Okay, we can actually go to the first slide. If it works. Oh gosh. I need some training here. Can you? Which button?
This direction. Should be that.
Okay, stay there. Okay. It's not on my screen here, is that right? Okay. Hello? Can you put it on the screen here?
It's not. Your presentation is not.
Okay, I'm sorry. I needed the screen. Okay. I'm Lars Muller. I'm the program manager for the Alcohol Illicit Drugs program in WSO Regional Office for Europe. We represent 53 countries marked in green here, and we are based in Copenhagen. In 1995, we started a special program on prison health, and we are still the only WSO region with such a program. At any time in Europe, we have about 2 million prisoners, but we have 6 times as many passing the prison walls every year. Globally, we have 10 million prisoners. We have a large number of prisoners who have mental problems, drug use problems. And prisons in most countries are isolated from public health because public health is under the Ministry of Health, and in most countries the health of prisoners is under the Ministry of Justice. Prison population differs a lot in Europe, very low in the especially Nordic countries and high here in Eastern European countries, especially Russia. Globally, United States is leading here with about 730 prisoners per 100,000 inhabitants. The prison population is a very selected group. We know from different studies, but I just give you some figures here. 67% were unemployed before going to prison. 58% of newly sentenced prisoners truanted from school regularly, and 46% had no qualifications. 65% of prisoners have numeracy skills at or below the level of 11-year-old, and 48% have reading skills at or below this level. 70% will have no employment in placement, in training, education or release, and 15% of prisoners live in temporary accommodations or are homeless before custody. So this is a very special population. It's also they are also very difficult to reach outside the prison walls. And compared to the general population, they have much higher rates of HIV, TB, hepatitis C and B, mental disorders, alcohol and drug dependence. Yes. Just one figure about HIV prevalence in the public system and in the prison system. An average, we talk about 30 times more frequent to have HIV if you are a prisoner compared to a general population. Prisons, it's a breeding ground for communicable diseases. We know there's a lot of injection of drugs in the prison walls. Those injecting drugs might have a safe behavior outside prison walls, but when they come into the prison, they have to share needles and syringes. And that also other tattooing, piercing, scarifications, unprotected sex is leading to these diseases. Yeah. Okay, we only have one systematic literature review from 2006 about alcohol abuse, alcohol dependence of prisoners going to prison. And these studies show that between 18 and 30% of men and 10 to 24% of women have an alcohol problem before going to prison. Alcohol is not a problem in the prison. It's very difficult to smuggle in alcohol. But many of these prisoners go to prison because of a crime under the influence of alcohol. And so it's a need to screen prisoners at entry and to find out who needs special treatment in order to reduce reoffending after release. The drug abuse dependence is severe, 10 to 48% of men, and even more, 30 to 60% of all women going to prison, they have a drug problem. And drug use is very often continued. It might to a lesser degree, but it continues in prisons. And if you inject drugs outside prisons, you most probably also do it inside prison walls. And we also see that drug service in prisons is not comparable to what's going on in the public system. It's not as good. And overdose deaths is also a huge problem, especially in the period just after release. I'll come back to that. We have a few studies on injection drug users, how much injection drug use is continuing in prisons. And for instance, we performed a study in 2006 in Kyrgyzstan and in two prisons, and there prisoners reported 75% of them reported to be injecting drugs there. So some countries have very high prevalences, but on average we are probably down to 10, 20%. But if you inject drugs, there's very increased risk of sharing. We see that about 80% of those injecting drugs, they actually share needles and syringes in prisons because there's no access to clean needles and syringes. Yes. In the principle 9 of the basic principle of the treatment of prisoners states, prisoners shall have access to the health service available in the country without discrimination on the grounds of their legal situation. So any prisoner should have the same health care in the prisons as they should receive in the public health system. And that's not the case in many, many countries. In the WSO, UNODC, UNAIDS comprehensive package, it stated a number of things that should be available in countries for all the population. That's needle and syringe exchange programs, drug treatment, including opioid substitution therapy, voluntary HIV counseling and testing, antiretroviral therapy, sexual transmitted infection prevention and treatment, and you can read the rest, I'm not going through it, but in many places this can be available in the community, but it's not available in the prison setting. We have got good evidence that the needles exchange, needle syringe programs, they are safe to use. We have good evidence, and still it's not introduced in many countries. We know drug consumption by inmates participating in this program are stable, or it's even decreased. The needles exchange sharing is almost eliminated. We don't see reported cases of new infections by HIV, hepatitis B and C. No, and we don't see that prisoners who do not inject before start injecting because of they have available needles and syringes, and so on. So it's quite safe to introduce this. And still, we only in Europe have 9 countries who have some or full coverage of needles exchange in systems in the prisons. And next slide, let's see. On opioid substitution therapy, we among our 53 member states, we now have 29 countries who provide this treatment. Also here we have convincing evidence it's very effective. And at the global level, we see where we have availability of opioid agonist pharmacotherapy, and that's mainly in high-income countries, both with methadone, buprenorphine, or buprenorphine naloxone, and it's going down in the if you have a lower middle and low-income countries. The same on guidelines on the pharmacological treatment of substance use disorders is much more frequent among higher-income countries. And programs that divert clients from away from the criminal justice system into treatment are also much more frequent in high-income countries. We still have many countries where just using drugs is a criminal act and you can go to prisons for that. That's not good for the drug-using prisoner, and it's not good for prisons. And prisoners who use drugs should go to treatment. Overdose death is a general problem, especially on release. And we estimate that 2/3 of these are accidental, and these are young people, mainly. And we see these cases the first 2 weeks after release from prison. There are a number of studies showing this. Some of these studies, if you compare to the general population, actually show more than a relative risk of more than 100 times to a general population the first 2 weeks for dying in an overdose. And if you compare the first 2 weeks to the rest of a year for the same for the prisoners, then it's about 10 times the risk. So it's really a group we need to take care of just after release, but we have to start before they are released. And we know the risk factors in the inject heroin, recent history of non-fatal overdose, longer injection career, high levels of use of intoxication, alcohol use, depression, and if there's no methadone program in the prison. And we can prevent these. I only show a few things here, but we need to train prisoners when they're in prison. We have to talk to them. We have to tell them the risk about it. Also, that you know, if they are in good treatment and if they are linked to the community service, we might prevent these cases. The best would be if the community service is actually taking responsibility for the treatment in prison setting. We, in 2010, we issued a publication on preventing these overdose deaths, and tomorrow we are opening a conference in Ireland, WSO together with the Irish Prison Service and Public Health England, and we have updated this publication, and there you will find all the recommendations. But the evidence base is much better than in 2010, but the recommendations are very similar to what we also proposed in 2010. So member states should do much more in this case. A few months ago, we launched a new publication on prisons and health. It's a textbook with all the most important areas of prison health. You also find drug treatment here, but it covers a lot of aspects on prison health. It's very easy to download, and also with the next publication. Good Governance for Prison Health in the 21st Century, a publication we launched a year ago. It's mainly to facilitate that the Ministry of Health is taking over the responsibility of prison health. So that's what we really recommended among our member states, that the Ministry of Health should be responsible for prison health service. That will also make a very strong link to public service and also to give much better treatment of prisoners and also much better treatment for drug users in the prisons. But these publications you can download from our website. Next slide. And that's it for me. Thank you.
Doktor Melo'ya teşekkürler. Gerçekten biraz unuttuğumuz ya da görmediğimiz bir alanda güzel şeylerden bahsetti. Gerçekten farklı bir dünya. O dünyada da mutlak ihtiyacı olan insanlar var. Şimdi aslında süremiz doldu ama bir iki tane soru size de bir 5-10 dakika belki verelim istiyoruz. Soru varsa alabiliriz. Buyurun. Evet.
Teşekkür ediyorum.
Önce kime sorduğumuzu da söylersin.
Doktor Moller'e soracağım. İsmim tamam. İlyas Kelik. Ben sivil savunma işleriyle ilgileniyorum. Afetin içerisinde bağımlılıklar görülmüyor. En azından Türkiye'deki afetler işte deprem, salgın hastalıklar, sosyal afetler falan. Bu şekilde algılanmadığı için de mücadelenin zayıf olduğunu düşünüyorum. Yani afet kapsamında yerel imkanların yetmezliği söz konusudur ki uyuşturucu olsun, diğer bağımlılıklara da yerel imkanlar yetmez. Ulusal hatta dünyanın, kürenin katkıları gereklidir. Brown hocam söyledi, 7'de 1 oranında 20-30 yaşlar arasında ölümler olduğunu söyledi. Bu konuda ciddi bir sıkıntılar var. Birleşmiş Milletler afet kapsamı içerisinde değerlendirmeyi düşünüyor mu? Teşekkür ederim. Uyuşturucu konusunu.
Hangi hocamıza sormuştuk? Tamam, buyurun.
Okay, thank you. WHO is providing a lot of guidance on aspects of all kind of treatments and also on drugs treatment. And these guidelines we are using to guide member states in drafting policies. That's also on alcohol. We have a global strategy, have a European action plans, and we have a lot of activities with member states. We are linked closely to the Ministry of Health in every member state, and there we are often asked if we could come and assist in developing new guidelines, new policies. So of course we are very eager to continue that and we do it as much as we can and as much as a member state would like us to do it. Because we know that we have good evidence for what we are doing and we have the policies in place.
Son bir soru. Buyurun.
Amongst the prisoners, females are more substance abusers. Was there any, actually we know amongst the general population, mainly the males are more dependent on substance. Why in the prison the females are more dependent?
I think I got the last part, but the female population, prison population, is only 5%, and most of these actually go to prison due to non-violent crime. So it's mainly related to their drugs problems. So maybe that's the reason why, where men are much more going to prison because of violent crime. But I don't know really in the case why women are more. But I think it's because they have a drug related crime, and that's the reason. But it's very few compared to men.
Teşekkürler. Sizlere de katılımınız ve sabrınız için teşekkür ediyorum. Hepinize afiyet olsun.